Hey guys, welcome back to Maxplain Dawn of War Unification. Today I have a faction guide for you for the Salamanders. The Salamanders are a Space Marine chapter that focuses on fire, flames. So it's flamers and melters. They have their, how should I say, expertise in. You even see his the commander here with a melter gun here and a fiery storm hammer. Or is it a fiery storm? It's a hammer on fire at least. I don't know much about the lore, but I heard that they are like the sturdy craftsmen, so they have a little crafty and whatnot, and they have all these charcoal black skin. That's because I think this is their planet that was burned down or something. So yeah, that's why this is. At least that's what I heard. Overall, they are very similar to the standard Space Marines. They are slower, but a little tankier, but yeah, because of their inherent slow nature, they have distinct weaknesses. It's very similar units in the early game, very special and interesting units in the later part. So yeah, all this we will see in the safe game. And here we are in the safe game. As always, we start with the basics in terms of resources and unit caps. Resources are standard requisition and power. The acquisition is also pretty standard. You build listening posts, you cap strategic points beforehand, you upgrade them, you get generators or thermoplasma generators and get upgrades. So it's all basic. Similar, the squad caps are also basic 2020 with a 10-0 start. You get two upgrades for infantry for plus 5 each and 4 upgrades for vehicles plus 5 each, and you get plus 2 vehicle cap for your machine bit, which is called anvil, I think. Yeah, your anvil. Yeah, that's that out of the way. Let's talk about their buildings. Buildings are pretty much the same as any standard Space Marine. You have your HQ, which has some special units, but that's your HQ, which your worker, your scout, your cap increases. You have your Furnace, which is your chapel barracks. You see there are some more units than for Space Marines here. You have your forge, which has some upgrades. In tier 2 you can build your Promethean cult, which is basically your hero training ground, where you get some extra heroes from. Basically everywhere you get some units that differ or are additional to the standard Space Marine units. The same is true for the anvil, which is their machine cult, machine pit thing, where you also get your tier 4 relic vehicles. And you have your Vault of Remembrance, which is your orbital relay. Yeah, you get your terminators and whatnot. Some special upgrades here, but I will go through the updates in the tech trees. I think it's the best place. In terms of generators, it's all the same. Interesting is that defense-wise, you cannot build turrets here. I think this will be changed in the next update. I think I read that somewhere, that they will get some turrets, flamer turrets and melter turrets. They have some minefields, they have their listening posts, which have flamers, so their range is, isn't the greatest. I think it's a little shorter range than the standard listening posts, and they have, I think it's heavy flamers for the upgrade listening posts. That's pretty much all for the buildings. Yeah, so let's talk about the units, and units are more interesting because they are differ a lot from, or have more differences in to the standard Space Marines. You have for your worker, you have a Tech Marine. The Tech Marine is not just the builder, he also has some good melee attack, but can also get, apart from this bolter, he gets also the upgrades for your hero upgrades. The hero upgrades are, I'll go through them quickly, are a flamer instead of a plasma pistol, and then there's a second upgrade for ranged weapon for commanders, that's a melter gun, and Tech Marine will also benefit from all the upgrades. Then you have the hammer time, which gives some hammers to some commanders. Deathwatch veteran, Hannafall, Half a Melee. Okay, and this one gives burning power swords, sergeant, scout, tactical. So this is for sergeants and this is for heroes. I think. Equips the Force Commander, Attack Marines with Flaming Thunder Hammers. So that's an upgrade which the Attack Marine also has impact on. Other than that, he's, as I told you, all the Salamanders really slow. For a builder, rather tanky, can build and repair. Costs a whole bunch, 110, and it's, yeah, building time is really, really long. Your commanders, you have quite a lot of different commander variants. In the middle you have your, what is it, your chapter master or your, it's a Primarch. I think it's a Primarch, yes. Vulcan, we will come to him last. So the best to task. You have a skull probe which can be infiltrated, detect and use sabotage. It's one of the few units in the Salamander roster that can actually detect. Even the librarian, we will come to him later, which is normally a detector. It's not stated here. I'm not sure if he is really not a detector, but at least it is not stated in the tooltip. Yeah, your primary commander is really your force commander here. First commander can get some upgrades for his weaponry. As always, is a pretty good fighter. Can get a Eye of Vulcan, which is kind of orbital bombardment basically, from the relay beacon. Has a passive damage aura, which can be researched, which is also standard for first commander, and has the ability to do the last man. The last man gives this aura around, which makes them unable to move, but the benefits are taking much less damage, but will unable to abandon the position. You see, they ignore move commands. The other tier 2 standard units are your librarian. Librarian has some different spells. It starts with Heart of Remembrance, Heart of the Furnace, which turns him on fire and damages him and nearby units, I think. Only enemy? It states only enemy. Interesting. I think it states... Okay, it also increases his close combat attacks with this nice sword he has. Then we have Vulcan's Anvil. Greatly enhances the ability of his body to withstand all attacks. So it's also a buff for himself, so it's a very self-buff dude. Then you have Nocturne's Fire. I've read through this all, but it's quite some time, sorry. The area around the Labyrinth is suddenly in fulgent rage inferno, which few things can withstand. The Labyrinth and his squad, in case he leads one, remain unhampered, move while it's been sustained. So it's a fire around him. Three of the Salamanders. Damage entrains morale of nearby enemy units. So this one is a flaming ground around him, will not hurt him, will it hurt allies? No. So this is nice. He cannot move while this is active. It shall be done. He will talk about him later. Then you have your chaplain. The chaplain does not state that it has a health regeneration aura, but he has, if the aura indicators around him are true. He has the what is it called? The names are really special. Canticle of Immolation. The chaplain reads aloud text, whatever. Nearby Salamander's infantry can increase concentration and thus accuracy. Additional order weapons will enchant it with Promethean heat, gaining armor precision capabilities. So it's not your demoralizing shout, or even it looks so, it gives a big buff to all damage of squads around. Is it only when it's cast, I think, yeah. And this one, the Fear of the Salamanders, probably, yeah, looks pretty much the same. Oh, can I walk with him? No, he's just standing there. Perhaps one of the Drake of the Mound of Deadfire planet Nocturne. It will to kill one as the right passage for Solomon. It cause damage and trains more out of enemy units. So it's just a nice detail. It's basically just an AoE damage attack. Other commanders you have access to is your Brand of Priest, which is a standard apothecary with some heavy regeneration aura. But you also have access to the Sister Hospital, also from the Sisters of Battle healer unit. They give only health regeneration to the squad elite, but they also give additional benefits. Let's she greatly increases health condition, morale, and regeneration of the squad elites. Carries her own standard weapons. Okay, so it's morale also. So she has a bigger health regeneration bonus, but only for the squad elites. Then we have the banner bearer, which is really awesome. The banner bearer, the aura he gives is minimum armor rating is increased, and armor penetration of their weapon projectiles is increased. So it's a defensive and offensive buff at the same time. Banner bearer, MVP, get him to the squad. You also have an additional hero that's similar to your three standard hero. It's a Death Watch veteran, also limited to one. It's an, you could say, an assault marine hero. It starts with a shield here. Can use melter bombs if research, can use rain of fire, which is a firing strike. It's probably a strain run, or it's also a orbital bombardment. Let's see. Okay, it's more like a strafing run. He can jump around, is really tanky for that, and cannot be attached to assault marine squad. I thought he can, but he cannot. Let's talk about the Primarch for a second. We have him here, big bald guy. He is basically a Titan Primarch unit, you could say. It's you need a relic and a critical occasion for him. He has quite the big hammer, so he can swing, pack a punch. He has also a big flamer. On the other hand, fire range is okay-ish. 7000 health is really good for commander armor. Has Endeshaw no Fear, which is a global ability. All elemental troops on his command in the armor are restored to full morale. Offering lasting unwavering resolve. Also morale immunity. Basically it's a, what is it called? Give me a second, what is it called? A rally ability, a global rally ability. Then he has two AoE abilities, one Scorch Earth. Heat in small areas, setting it in flame. Infantry, demons and commanders. So it's an AoE ability against infantry, you could say, and this one is an melter orbital strike. So he has now an area which they take damage, and you have also a melter orbital strike, which is good against vehicles, but you need to target it. And he can also teleport around really fast also. What I did not told you about the Force Commander is that once you have all the two commander upgrades. Hey, come on, let me click. And are in tier 3.5, you can decide commander upgrade. You can give him Terminator armor, make him a Primaris, and or a commander vehicle. Also interesting. If you give him Terminator armor, he will immediately change to a Terminator. If you choose Primaris or vehicle, you need to first let him die and then rebuild him. I will show you the Terminator armor. We will research it and we will jump over to the Primaris variant, which I have on another player basically here. It's a Primaris command squad with the big commander in the middle. They still have their abilities, like their passive abilities, their orbital bombardment to the last man. And for them you can research very late in the game also jetpacks, so they are faster and can jump around. You start with the Force Commander in the middle and can add up to two retinues. You have to choose between four variants. The first two are more melee based, so this has a Storm Shield and Thunder Hammer. The second one has a pair of Lightning Claws. The third one has a Mastercrafted Storm Bolter and a Flaming Sword. This is this guy. And the last one has a Mastercrafted Bolter and a Power Fist. This is this guy. So you decide if you are sticking, if you have all flaming swords, so this will look nicely. Yeah, so these are more hybrid, you could say, and these are melee only. Now, yeah, the Force Commander got changed to a Terminator now. You can see him. He keeps, of course, his abilities, can now teleport. I think you need to research that, though. There's a standard research. The standard Space Marines also have to give their Terminators teleportation capabilities, which is also true here for the Force Commander. And that's not all. You can now also give him some special weaponry. You can give him a freaking missile port on the top. And then you can decide what their hand weapons should be. You can go full melee with dual lightning claws. You can go full melee with Thunderhammer and Storm Shield. And you can get melee and ranged with a Relic Blade or Chain Fist. And on the ranged part, you have a Heavy Flamer and Multi Melter. Yeah, so you can decide what to do. So this guy looks freaking badass. Can he attach? He can also be attached to a squad, to a Terminator squad. So you have a big Terminator running around with this step up, basically with your assault Terminators, preferably. Last option, the command tank is here. I parked him right next to the tank he will ride. He rides a Land Raider Redeemer. Has also the abilities of Land Raider Redeemer, that is the unload ability and the machine spirit. He can also use the Eye of Vulcan and To the Last Man, and has this aura. So it's basically he's sitting here, so that's why this now is a commander vehicle. And he has also the EMC side, which if you look here where there is Fog of War, gives him a big radius and showing enemy nearby units. I'm not sure if this also gives true sight detection or not. It is not stated. But that's your commanders out of the way. So you have in tier 3.5 the choice what to go for. My personal opinion, I like the Land Raider, so you have another vehicle. It takes up rear cap though. If you don't want to take any cap up, Terminator would be your option. These Primaris command squad takes up infantry cap. So yeah, pros and cons for all variants. With the commanders out of the way, we will jump over to the infantry. And the infantry in the beginning is very similar to Space Marine. You have scouts. They look in the beginning very similar, but with one less model. You can also have rally and doomfire grenades. One thing about the grenades, you can research them in tier 1, but cannot use them until tier 2 because you need sergeants. Only the sergeants can throw the grenades. We can build, so to demonstrate it, I built another scout marine here, and you will see that they will not be able to throw the grenade unless they have the scout sergeant. This is true for all infantry squads that can throw grenades. I think it's true for all. Correct me if I'm wrong. Standard weapons they have access to when you build their forge, which is their armory, is the flamer and combat shotgun. So it's a shotgun. Where they are here. You see, they have no grenades. They need to get the scout leader. You noticed on the weapons that they have access to sniper rifles, which you can research in tier 1 directly. So they can have sniper rifles. Cool and dandy. But in tier 2 you can get a upgrade after that gives them heavy weapons, heavy bolters and missile launchers. That in combination with their ability to infiltrate after a very costly upgrade, to be honest, then you have like infiltrated missile launching scouts. That's awesome, to say the least. That's really awesome. So just to show it, now they can throw their Doomfire grenades. The Doomfire grenades are your standard grenades, but they set the enemy on fire, similar to the Sister of Battle grenades. Yeah, then you have your standard tactical marines. They look very similar, but as I told you, they are slower. I think they are slower. They feel slower than standard space marines, right? I think they are a little more tanky, and they have more upgrades later on, but still, they're really slow. Can also get the sergeant, which gives them the rally ability and the doomfire grenades. Can get flamers in tier 1, melter guns and heavy boulders in tier 2, and a multi-melter in tier 3 for the heavy weapons. Then you have also assault marines. Assault marines similar to all the Marines, can have a rally when they have their sergeant, and these get melter bombs with their sergeants. They can jump, of course, get flamers in tier 1 and melter guns in tier 2. Yeah, they aren't as slow as the other ones because of their jetpacks. That's tier 1 of the way. I will shortly move these out of the way to get rid of these effects here. Jump. And then we have the Order of the Ancient Shroud Elite Squad, which is a Sist of the Battle Squad for Salamanders. Their Blinking Armor here is a tier 4 upgrade, which gives them some nice bonuses. I forgot, I will need to read that through again. You can build them in tier 2. They can also fire Doomfire grenades, I think. These are the only troops that can fire it right away, right? Can you use Doomfire grenades? No, you need the Legatine Veteran. So they have three different leaders. You can get the Legatine Veteran, limit 1, and then you can get up to 2 different. Or you can skip that and get 3 in total, I'm not sure, but you can get a Retribution Sister with a Heavy Incinerator or the Retributor Sister with a Multimelter. This one is tier 2, these two, and this one is tier 3. For the weapons, you get a Flamer, you get a Multimelter, Storm Bolter, and Heavy Bolter. I'm myself not very. Okay, this is medium range and this is a long range, that's the difference. The Storm Bolter is a little more expensive, so I guess it has more punch. It also has the Shield of Faith, which is a glorified rally ability. Protects the squad from harm. The shield nullifies shield effects from most enemy psychic powers. It also restores the full morale and whatnot. So it's a better rally, you could say. And it's also got by the Legatine Veteran. So you always want to have this lady here. She's really expensive and takes quite a lot of time to build, but she is worth it. Tier 2, you have also access to the Forge Guard squad. The Forge Guard is a melee superiority unit, limited to 2 squads. These sisters is limited to 1 squad. I have to say, we will see it in the tech trees, these two also need the Forge, so your tier 1.5 building. So just getting tier 2 won't give you access to those two, you also need the Forge for it. The Forge Guard, it makes sense that you need the Forge for the Forge Guard though. Is, as I stated, the melee superiority build can get the rally ability from their Forge Guard Sergeant and get a wide variety of melee weapons. They can get Lightning Claws to shred out infantry and also some heavy infantry, but a bigger punch comes later. The Power Gags, very effective against Commanders, Demons and Morale. And I think they are all flaming, right? It doesn't state here, but we have the Flaming Thunder Hammer, which you need to upgrade here. The two upgrades here, the Hammer Time for the Flaming Hammers and the Burning Swords for the Flaming Swords for this Forge Guard. So it's interesting that you have an upgrade that not only affects your commanders but also a squad. You have Flaming Thunder Hammers, which are Thunder Hammers that also deal flaming damage, and then you have the Burning Power Sword, which is also pretty nice. Flames that can kill the enemy even long after the last stroke fell, so has a long-lasting DPS. Infantry and Demons, and this is more probably against, yeah, most targets, including vehicles, so bigger targets, you could say. That's the tier 2 stuff out of the way, and then in tier 3 and 3.5, they basically explode. The biggest squad they have access to, it's limited to, is their Primaris Aggressor squad. These guys are nuts. I think the damage they deal is a little, I will not say broken, but I think it will be turned down a bit. So a tip for now, always stick to the basic weapons, don't get any upgrades. You can get the Primaris Aggressor Sergeant, probably this guy in the middle, which gives them a rally ability, and they can get teleport ability when you research the personal teleporters. So it's not your Terminators, but also your Primaris Aggressor squad. They can get Flame Storm Gauntlets, Power Fists that also have a heavy flamer, so they get a little more melee based. And they can also get Frackstorm grenade launchers, which makes them anti-vehicle. But as they are, their damage is good against everything, which is probably a little bug in the game. The other Primaris squad you have access to, these are limited to 2, and I think this one is limited to 1, is a Primaris Eradicators squad. These guys have as you see, really long range. They cannot use the teleport ability, but can use Doomfire grenades once they have their sergeant, and can get Melter Rifle. Melter Rifles are, as stated here, very, how should I say, I thought it stated that they are very rare, but they can have access to it. Melter Rifles is a long range melter damage, which is also always good. Other than that, they have their bolters here, which also have very long range. So this is your more of your ranged support unit. Let's see how one looks like. Don't see that very often. There we have it. So, okay, looks a little slimmer than your standard melter. Okay, then once you have your build your orbital relay, you can get assault terminators, of course, which have thunder hammers and storm shields, can have the terminator leader with dual flaming lightning claws. So it's not lightning claw, it's a flaming claw, I guess. And then you have your terminator squad, range Ryan, which can get assault cannons and heavy flamers, which is also standard, but they also get a sergeant here, which has a cyclone missile launchers, sword on fire, flaming fire sword, and storm boulders. And then you also have access to the fire drakes. I think this is tier 3.5 as well, or it's tier 4. Fire drakes are special melee only terminators, you can see here. They have flaming thunder hammers, storm shields, and look really badass. Just look at this. And can get a special leader, Tushan. I don't know him, he's probably a big guy in the lore. They can teleport without getting the teleporter upgrade, I think. And he has two abilities here, the leader. He only gets access to the leader. Core Lightning is similar to the lightning field, I think, of what the Necronaut has. But you don't get the passive. Because from the lightning field from the Necron Lord, you also get some thorn armor, so the enemy attacking you will get some attacks damage back. And you can summon an easy alliance, which is not compatible with all Sisters of Battle Squad. So goodbye, sister, and Sister Hospitaller here, sorry, see you later. And if you don't have any sisters up, you can summon a squad of demonets. There they are. What the fuck? Why are there three now? Lol. I think this is a bug of the unlimited addon, because you get one squad, okay? One squad of these beautiful ladies that you're very good against different demons and can use the allure ability, which makes the enemy what is it? Victims lose their mind, attack their allies. So it's an confuse ability. It's a very useful. I think they don't cost resources, but I'm not sure about it. And yeah, if you have them, you can get the sisters normally, and you don't. Yeah, can't get the sister Hospitaller. Yeah. I think this is a bug, or it's made for the unlimited add-on. You don't can have sisters and the demonettes here. Warp entities counts as elite infantry. No longer considered a creature of the warp. That's why they have no instability. Because her nature, she cannot regenerate wounds, so that's interesting. But you see the cooldown isn't the greatest, so you can resummon them whenever you want. Whenever it's ready. So that's pretty much it. One thing, the little AoE effect here is an aura from the fire drakes themselves, not from the leader. Inspiring warriors that raise morale of nearby salamanders, and they are fearless themselves. So that's the little aura around them. It's a morale increasing aura. Okay, that's the infantry. Let's go to the vehicles, and vehicles are very special. You can get a tier 1 vehicle once you get the forge out of from your HQ, which is the Thunderfire cannon. Very similar to the Thunderfire cannon of the Imperial Fists, a little less effective, I think, DPS wise. It's very slow and you cannot summon it in the field as the Imperial Fist, so it's a little more defense based. So the idea why the Salamanders don't have a turret is that they have these mobile kind of turrets on the fire cannon, and I can tell you that it works very well as a mobile turret. As you are really slow, you are really, how should I say, harassment strategies work very well against you. And having one Thunderfire cannon in the back of your base defending your first 3 to 2, 2 to 3 to 4 listening posts against, for example, Bespit harassment, it's really, really useful. In tier 2 you can get another of these vehicles. These don't cost a vehicle cap but are limited to 3 each. You get a Rapier Armor Destroyer, which is meant for building a vehicle. Here this is stated to infantry, heavy and infantry commander, but also does considerable damage against small buildings. So this is your anti-infantry kind of, and this is your anti vehicle, but you can see these are really slow, especially the Thunderfire cannon. Yeah, it will take a while. Here are your more standard vehicles in tier 2. When you get tier 2 and build the anvil, you get access to a Rhino, which is your standard Rhino, has a place for two squads, I think, can get a heavy flamer and can use smoke launchers once upgraded. The racetrack is similar to a Rhino but only has one space to transport, so it's a more offensively based, has two weapons here, Storm Bolter, and I think this is also a bigger Storm Bolter, but you can upgrade them to a Twin-Licked Heavy Flamer, which is the thing to go. You don't need a forge or anything for that. For the Assault Cannon you need a forge, and the Multi-Melter Gun is for tier 3 exclusive. So I think the Twin-Linked Heavy Flamer is really nice. It also has a really nice big effect. You can get up to 3 of the Razorbacks. It takes up 2 supplies, so highly recommended to get them. Your other tier 2 vehicles is your Dreadnought, which is more or less your standard Dreadnought. Melee focus, can get a Heavy Flamer and a Multi-Melter instead of the Assault Cannon, I think what it is the normal can get. So yeah, more mid-range based if you get these upgrades. And then you have this land speeder, and you see, oh, land speeder lame, but this land speeder is amazing. He costs an arm and a leg. It's 250 requisition, yeah, and 50 power. I'm not sure about the prices for the standard space marine, but this sounds like a big cost, but a very low cost on power, in fact. So if you build anvil and don't have an access on power, which you would need, for example, for a Dreadnought, which, to be honest, looks really nice with this Drake here, get land speeders. You can get up to 2 land speeders. They have, I think, a gun at the side here. They have a bolter, a heavy bolter here. They have a flamer, so they're really good at mincing enemy infantry. Nothing stated here, but they are good at enemy infantry. And in tier 3, I think you can get Multi-Melter Gun. So we have jumping land speeders with melters. Really, really good. In tier 3, you get access to your Predator. And the Predator starts out with your standard variant, plus a guy with a Storm Bolter on the top. So you have your Assault Cannon, I think. Or your Battle? No, I think it's an Assault Cannon. Twin Bolters on each side and a Storm Bolter on top. But you can get here patterns. Patterns basically change the full weapon loadout of your tank, and you can get these weapon upgrades for the guy on top. So we have an Inferno. Is this the Inferno pattern? Yes. The Inferno pattern, as the name states, gives them this nice looking heavy flamer with this Drake on top. Really awesome. Gives them heavy flamers left and right, a big heavy flamer on the top, and I also upgraded the heavy flame on the top, so it's all flames, all anti-infantry flames. Other pattern you can get is the Magma pattern, which gives them melters everywhere. The big melter on the top, melters at the side, melter for this guy if you upgrade this Multi-Melter here. So you can, as for the most stuff for Salamanders, decide if you want to go with flames or melters. anti-infantry, anti-vehicle. In tier 4, you get access to one of these. Either a whirlwind, anti-infantry, long range, really long range, or a vindicator, anti-everything, big punch, battle cannon here at the top, for mid-range artillery, you could say. So if you need to stay your distance and fighting infantry, get a whirlwind. If you can get a little close and fighting bit of bigger foes, get the vindicator. You can get only one of these, only one whirlwind or one vindicator. They share a cap, you could say. Now we come to the big guys, you could say, to your relic vehicles. These are all your relic vehicles. The two at the front, the Venerable Dreadnought and the Punisher Assault Tank here, have only their, how should I say, you can get only one, but it's not a shared cap. The Storm Raven and the Redeemer share a cap, you can only get each, or you can get Vulcan. Vulcan, the Storm Raven and the Redeemer share one limit. Let's start with the Venerable Ironclad Dreadnought, which is a melee-focused Dreadnought, as you would suggest. Looks really awesome with this flaming stuff at the head and these Salamander Drake symbols here. He has a flamer at his wrist, so also pretty standard. Can get upgraded with a Hurricane Bolter, which is your long-ranged support. And anti-infantry or your Inferno Melter Gun. Inferno Melter Gun. Okay, I only thought it was a heavy flamer, but Inferno Melter Gun sounds a bit better. Medium range, sets enemies on fire, causing lasting damage. Vehicles, buildings, also good against heavy infantry. Okay, interesting. Let's see how this one looks. Where is it? Is this here on the bottom now? Was this here now? Haven't seen it really, sorry. On the top. At least you now have it. You can also use smoke launchers when researched. And then you have your Sikaran Punisher Assault Tank, which looks awful lot similar to one of the tanks the Imperial Fist have access to. Has this, I would say this, what is it called? Chain gun? Also similar. Big bolters at each side, has a storm bolter at the front and a small storm bolter guy on the top. Is, as it states, good against infantry and heavy infantry. Yeah, it's a Gatling gun. Sorry, now I found it. And this one probably upgrades the guy on top to a flamer or a multi melter. Can get the machine spirit, which is lowers the tank's speed but is more resistant to damage for a short amount of time. Has also access to hunter killer missiles. Ah, one thing here, the things on top are Hunter Killer Missiles, so he also has some anti-vehicle capabilities around the Dreadnought. So these are should automatically, and these you need to target and cost resources. I don't think they cost resources here. So let's see. Yeah, the guy on top now has a multi-melter. Yeah. The last big things you have is your Land Raider Redeemer here. Yeah, very good against buildings and vehicle states, so it has melters, and I think this is a big storm bolter here, and also has melters, so a big melter based land raider. Can use also the machine spirit to make him a little harder to kill for a short amount of time, and smoke launchers. Can also transport units including terminators. And then you have this storm raven gunship with which the weapons, I'm not sure, this looked like a triple dual twin linked storm bolter or whatnot, and some bolters at the top. If they fire, they look like they are just looking cool, but you also have some Gatling guns on the top. It is not a flyer. It has a low altitude, so it cannot fly. It can jump, however, and it can land to transport units. When it lands, of course, it's immobile. And yeah, it's sitting duck basically. I'm not sure if the weapons. I think if it's on the ground, it cannot. It's become terribly immobile in order to bring heavy weapons to bear. Okay, so just to unload heavy weapons. So a Storm Raven here, rather fast, not as tanky as a Land Raider, of course. I don't like these low altitude vehicles, to be honest. I would rather see a real flying Storm Raven, but that's my personal opinion on it. Okay, let's look at my little list here, if I have forgot something. Oh no, no. I think this is all it for now. As always, if I have forgot something to tell you also, please tell me in the comments. And for now, we will jump into the tech tree. And here we are on the tech tree document. Yeah, I think there's nothing special to understand compared to other tech trees. I just want to go quickly through some upgrades, how are the dependencies. We will start with the HQ, where you get the sniper rifle upgrade right away and need tier 2 for the heavy weapon upgrades for your snipers, also for your sniper infiltration. In general, your HQ is really busy doing a lot of things. It's not like other HQ buildings you just build, get your capping units, your builders, and then you forget about it. You get all your squad cap upgrades, you get your upgrades for your scouts, you get these Thunderfire cannons and rapiers, you get your chaplain, which is also standard, and you upgrade it all the way to tier. I think I forgot one upgrade here. I need to add one upgrade here. I think it's make it on the fly. This one. I will make a little line here. And you have all the upgrades in the HQ add-on based. So once you use the HQ, you're basically tier one again. So really bad news there. But you're always busy doing something for your HQ, so make sure that you have enough workers, for example, for your tech up. Different upgrades, interesting upgrades is from your hero building stuff. You get the aura and then the ability from your force commander, which is standard, and then you get after your first two commander health and regeneration upgrades, you get access to one of the force commander specializations. For your orbital relay, you directly have access to your teleporter research, and once you have that research, you can research if you have an Primaris force commander, you can get access to their jetpacks. But mostly I want to talk about the upgrades in the Forge. You can upgrade the flamer immediately, the flamer for your commanders. At first doesn't make sense, because who gets access to it? There is only your force commander in tier 1. But also your tech marines get access to it. So you can get a few tech marines with flamers in tier 1, which work better than you would expect. You can also then upgrade them to melter guns in tier 2, which is really nice. If you go, for example, quadruple hero, you can not only go like triple hero, like force commander, chaplain, librarian, you can get also the death watch veteran, which is fourth hero, so you have quadruple hero play if you want to. Interesting to notice that your bionics, your HP upgrades, you need to always research before your targeters, your damage, range damage upgrade. It's always dependent on it. Even the second level, you first need to have the second level bionics before you can get the second level targeters. This upgrade gives you more heavy weapons, as it states here. The flaming sword and the flaming hammer I have talked about, and the flaming hammer gives you access to this upgrade, which I actually have forgot what it does. It's also some commander-like weaponry for a lot of commanders, increasing, giving them better weapons. It's like for all commanders you have, they give better weapons or increasing the damage. So that's why it also requires a relic, tier 3 though. And the last upgrade here is the upgrade for the sisters, giving them an increased armor rating, so, and they get better, not just better health, but and better armor class, you could say. And this shining effect is also that the enemy around them gets damage over time around them, which does not affect allies. Something I forgot about the squad. We will talk about quickly here. Where is it? Here. T gives true sight. this leader I thought you should always get, this with the angel wings, but the true sight only has melee range, so if you fighting against detectors, this can help a bit, but not really. Other than that, your detectors are very rare. You have your skull probes, which are really fragile, so you need to take care of it. And other than that, I think it's your Land Raider Redeemer hero here, which has True Sight, and that's it. That's at least everything is stated in the game. If you know that from some source that there are more detectors, please tell me. Yeah, your weapon upgrades always require the forge and some tech upgrades and a forge, for example, for the higher tier. So you will need a forge for a lot of things in this faction, including, as I stated when I was talking about the units, where if you look at the barracks here, you need to get tier 2 and a forge to get access to these new units. So forge is pretty much mandatory, at least once you want to head to tier 2. I think you can also get some vehicles out, but the vehicles are also limited to forge some, at least. Where is it? This is my vehicle building, right? This one. You will see that you need a forge for the Rhino and Razorback. So even if you rush to Razorbacks, you need a forge. Things you can get without a forge from the anvil are your land speeders and your dreadnoughts. Okay, here you see the turrets in survival. The turrets in survival are the variant that you have for most or for some other factions as well, that you get random arms. It's either a heavy flamer or a melter, so you can't really tell beforehand, which is a bit sad, I think. I would have hoped that you would build a heavy flamer turret and then you can manually upgrade it to a melter turret. It would be more in line with the faction in general and how turrets work for other factions. Last thing I want to talk about the units here is the units you get in survival. It's scouts. These ones are special. I will talk about them quickly later. Tier 3, you get access to another dreadnought. Tier 4, to another predator. And if you play on harder and higher, you get another Land Raider Redeemer. This is a Stern Guard Veteran squad here. You get in tier 2. The Stern Guard Veteran is basically a Space Marine on steroids. They can use the Doomfire grenades without having a commander, which is really nice. If it's researched, of course. They can get combi flamers. They can get combi melters. They can get a heavy flamer. They can get heavy bolters. They can get missile launchers. And they can get multi-melters. So you have quite a lot of weapon choices. Note that there only are a few units that can rocket launchers here. So the standard Space Marines cannot get rocket launchers. Quickly skim over to them. You hear? Can only get multi-melters and heavy bolters. Only squads access to rocket launchers is your scouts and in survival your Stern Guard veterans. Salamanders in general are really low ranged otherwise. I mean, their flamers have quite a good range compared to flamers of other factions, but still. Okay, that's about it about the tech tree. Let's talk about some build orders. And here we are at the build orders. As this, the Salamanders are pretty similar to Space Marines, you can basically play similar build orders with them. With the thing in mind, you have to keep in mind that your Marines are really slow. So you want to have something more defensive in mind most of the time. So these standard Space Marine build orders that rely on more aggression will fall, I wouldn't say fall apart, but struggle against some harassment threats because your units are really, really slow. Note here that I say you can get tier 2 with only a singular generator. Why is that? Your tier 2 only costs 125 power, which is really, really cheap on the power side. So you can get a really early tier 2 most of the time. Yeah, so your standard build order is similar to what Space Marines get. You get a Not a builder unit, which is your Tech Marine. Get 2 scouts, 2 cap, get your barracks, a Space Marine, and your Force Commander, and a gen. Add at least 1 Space Marine on the way, and then tech to tier 2. You can also use Space Marine spam, but as I told you, it's not as effective because you're really slow. You can, yeah, it's pretty much the same. You get 2 scouts, 1 tech priest, but skip this first generator, so you only have power for your Force Commander, and then get another Space Marine out because of that, because you save the money on the generator. Later on the line, you will want to add at least 2 more Space Marines, then you have your 10 supply full, like 4 Space Marines, 2 supply each, scouts 1 supply each, so you can sustain 4 Space Marines. If you want to make a real Space Marine spam, you would also want to get the squad cap upgrades from your HQ and get more Space Marines out. Later, you should of course add a generator and your armory to get your upgrades and some flamers on your guys. Don't get the grenades, because you only have access to the grenades in tier 2, which makes this Space Marine spams a lot less viable than your Space Marine spam from your standard Space Marines or different Space Marine factions, because grenades in tier 1 are really useful. So not as good as for standard Space Marines. You can also go Assault Marines, but I know the stuff I hear I present you for Assault Marines is probably not optimal. You can get 2 Assault Marine squads with this setup, but the question is, do you really want 2 Assault Marine squads in games? I know that, but as I'm not a Space Marine main, I keep this here. You can get also some health upgrades for them, because they are melee based. You don't want to have the targeters. That doesn't help you a lot. Get 1 or 2 more generators before you get to tier 2. The scout spam is really nice. Let's say rather cheap tier 1 if you want to have a fast tier 1, tier 2. You get a second builder and then get 4 scouts, which is the maximum. They are capped at 4, and get their sniper rifle upgrade, and then you get the heavy weapons that you need. If you have a melee squads approaching you, get at least 1 of those squads some shotguns. If the enemy is demons, get some flamers. If you have commanders or long-ranged enemies, get some sniper rifles. All fine and dandy. Get also the upgrades, the scouts benefit from them, and 10 tech to tier 2. Get the infiltration, get the heavy weapons, and have fun. This is the first build order here, the Thunderfire Cannon Push, that is exclusive to the Salamanders compared to, I mean, the heavy weapon is also exclusive to these, but the standard build order with sniper rifles is also possible with standard Space Marines, but this, the Thunderfire Cannon Push, is very effective and very unique to this faction. Starts off really standard. You get your Tech Marine, your 2 scouts. You get a armory, a forge, and a generator. And this allows you to get 3 Thunderfire cannons, which is the maximum, which you either want to keep at your base to defend if you get terrorists, or B, which is the more important part, get to the enemy base. So this is more effective on smaller maps, of course. And then you build up 2 more tech priests. So you have additional tech priests that can support your Thunderfire cannons by either repairing, or once you get the flamer upgrade, also dealing a lot of damage. And here comes the question, if you want to do it, if you have the enemy, like if the enemy struggles with that, you can get a barracks and add 2 Space Marines, some more generators, and get tier 2. So the Space Marines are here to solidify your position in the enemy base, you could say, or next to the enemy base. You can also skip that and get your tier 2 and then get some high tier stuff. Relies on your Thunderfire cannons being alive all time in tier 1. So that's why your Tech Marines are here. So Tech Marines, really nice with flamers, I have to say. This upgrade is really expensive, 100 requisition, 100 power. But if you see, like, I would always keep 1 Tech Marine back in the base to building stuff. But you can get 3 Thunderfire cannons, 3 Tech Marines pressing the issue, dangerous stuff. The last thing I have here is a tier 2 rush, which is really fast for salamanders as you only need one generator because your tech only needs 125 power. Really fast tier 2, for example, for a fast anvil. And then you can get the land speeders. And keep in mind, the land speeders only cost 50 power, so you don't need to have built like 5 or 3 to 4 additional generators to afford a freaking dreadnought, for example. You can get tier 2, build an anvil, and get the 2 land speeders out really quick and annoy the enemy. That's basically the idea of the tier 2 rush. Okay, that's the build orders, and as always, I finish up with a replay I have, and I tell you what, this replay is really nice. It basically showcases almost all aspects the salamanders can have. It's a game I have played against Shakma, aka number 6567. It is 20 minutes long, so if you want, pause the video, get a snack, get a drink, and yeah, prepare for some for awesome game. And here we are on the replay, where I played salamanders, of course, against Shakma, aka number 6567, playing Tau Empire. He goes with Tau Barracks opening, which is pretty standard, but we stick to my view to show my strategy here. I go for the Thunderfire push, so I have a forge build here and a plasma generator, getting 2 scouts now. And I think it's finishes all nicely that I can build immediately after the forge finish, the last scout is on the field, so I can start the Thunderfire cannon. Yeah, at least pretty close. Scout here. Almost same timing. So now I have 2 scouts out to cap some stuff and get now Thunderfire cannons to press the issue. This wasn't the first game I played against Shakma this day, so I know that there will be some Vesper harassment, so you will notice that I am well aware of it with the later Thunderfire cannons I built. So now I get this opening is rather cheap on the requisition, so that's why I'm getting a second plasma generator rather quickly. Should also note it in the build order, I guess. So I can, even though I have built all this, I can now also get the listening post up. And you notice here that I pause my Thunderfire cannons here to defend here against the Tau Commander and Vespids. And you see, against infantry they deal quite good damage, and one Thunderfire cannon is here firing away at the listening post. One thing to note about Thunderfire cannons, their vision range is only like this, but their firing range is about this, so if you have some units to spot for them, it's really nice. Now the Tech Marine is attacked here. I know I moved this Thunderfire cannon right in the middle of these three listening posts, so it can defend all, and would need to move this Thunderfire cannon to the front, because one, it's dealing damage, but it's not a lot. Now I get the Flamer upgrade and get at the Tech Marines here, upgrading listening posts where my generators are to defend it, of course. So I'm fine with sticking at my 4 points in the beginning and applying pressure to his base, getting also one critical location here. Lost one scout in the process, I think when it was on the move over there. Is the flame upgrade done? Yes. So now I'm upgrading listening post to get my economy up, getting the Tech Marines to the front, and now moving also the Thunderfire cannon to the front because I have upgraded for some of the listening posts here, and you see flame damage is really good for a freaking builder unit. I also built a second scout marine, another scout marine to decap the squads here. I found it interesting that this strategic point is not yet built, probably because of his expensive opener with the Vespids and Tau Commander. And he also had to reinforce the Red Spits, which are really expensive, 50 requisition on that. But now he lands in the middle of two listing posts and a Scout Marine Scout, so no way he can harass anything here. The Tau Commander gets really low from the Thunderfire cannons, and the Tech Marine happily roasts away at this listing post, also decapping his strategic point here. This is what I meant with the having the enemy at his base. I now kill his generators, which are high priority targets. See if I can here get this relic, but I see Vespid, so I turn around. So this is probably the point where if you play against AI or a not as experienced player, you will win. But just reveal it for a second. Chakma is always already tier 2 or almost there. I'm getting tier 2 as well on good time. So he has probably stealth suits everywhere. I mean, I know the Reaper, he has stealth suits, quite a lot of stealth suits that will deal with these Thunderfire cannons at some point. Now I see the Tau Commander and I should move at least one Thunderfire cannon further up to deal damage to him. Kill this listing post as well, and here we see some stealth suits that are visible. I would need to focus it, but I'm eager to kill the enemy economy, moving forward to kill the plasma generator here. I also upgrading this listing post because I feel that I'm in a winning position and want to finish the game, but probably not the best move. Now we see that the Tau Commander, he is revealed that Chakma is tier 2 with the Tau Commander having a missile launcher here. And you see that the pulse rifles here, fusion blasters, make short work out of the Thunderfire cannons, killing all three Thunderfire cannons. The Tech Marines will also die. I should have cancelled this because this will also be killed by the stealth suits that infiltrate. Are they revealed by the Tech Marine? Tech Marine a detector? No, it's not. Not sure where the detection come from. The Thunderfire cannon? Weird. Yeah, I move into range here and try to defend it, but yeah. I'm tier 2 now. And getting my furnace. I should have got the furnace earlier, but I'm getting Commander Web, Melter Weapon Research, because I want to transition to hero play. You see, I built Chaplain and some Tech Marines. Tech Marines also will get the Melter gun upgrade, so that's why I have some spare resources. So that's my plan for now. He's still busy getting his points back, so that buys me some time. Getting the Promethean Cult, of course, getting the Force Commander out, getting the Chaplain out. Don't spam Tech Marines, because I think heroes are more durable, so I want to stick with heroes. So it's a little slow move now. At this point, which I'm really slow at, I should have already gotten Scalp Ropes. I just now started. I have not Chaplain here, which can't do much against these, because you can't see him, but Skull Probe is on the way. Force Commander always also halfway built. You see the damage is immense against the commanders, it's pretty much insane. Trying to keep the Skull Probe alive, I need to research the invisibility. Using his ability here a little too early, but it helps him to defend for now. Force Commanders here getting the Death Watch Veteran. I'm getting the Commander Veteran upgrade first before getting the Librarian, because I have already have almost three heroes on the field, two heroes that are out right now, getting one upgrade, getting all the Skull Probes in the world, because we have quite a lot of infiltrated stuff to deal with. These two commanders going in by themselves, probably not the best idea. Would probably have to give them a squad. Don't take much damage, do they? And here we have some Breacher squads, and I don't give a damn. I'm moving in. problem is the stealth suits. I can't see the stealth suits. I mean, the regeneration of the chaplain is immense, but yeah, if he gets focused down, he dies really quickly. Now here my tech marines killing some stealth suits because they want to take my point. So my force commander will also die here. Not without taking some. I also gave him the thunderfire. The flaming hammer. Yeah, getting now more scouts to get my strategic points back. Having librarian out a little too late. Having the death watch veteran and the librarian here to smack on this listening post. Yeah, that's pretty much it. Now I decide to get the sister squad. I think I should have gotten it earlier without not getting too over eager with my heroes. Wait to put the leaders at some squads. Creatures are not fully reinforced, so can smack at them. He got a thunder hammer to the face, poor guy. He got just melted. So yeah, some tech marines also here. And we have on the other side these annoying stealth suits, killing even generator of mine. But I have my sisters now, and I gave them heavy boulders for the longer range. There's my Deathmount veteran, Tech Marine, and Librarian on this side. And here I'm trying to defend, which is really difficult. Killing my barracks as well. But he let go for a moment. Also busy defending in his base, to be honest. Where are my brothers? So the Deathmount veteran is really nice. He's a really fast hero, so he's really nice to have him able to fight enemy stuff. Not sure about I think this hammer he got from the upgrade, he does not get melters and whatnot. Yeah, now I use the flaming ability, which I should toggle off now, but I am busy microing somewhere else. Getting this position back here, getting the aura for my force commander, which is not even present, so not the best upgrade here. Where is my having my two heroes to survive, and now pulling back, getting my point back, getting also the relic here, getting some sort of foothold back, getting tech marine, and then you see my resources. I can tech up to tier 3 if I'm able to defend this here. Two squads of creatures, two stealth suits. He gets some damage from the listening post, and I'm sitting here with heavy bolter sisters, and he decides to get for the listening post, which is fine by me because I just want to have some time. Getting also the devastator doctrine, which would allow my sisters here to get more heavy weapons. Thinking of getting another librarian, but I think I decide against it in a moment. They jump in, but I have now scalp ropes, so no way to get here. So I cancel the librarian to get the furnace back, pick up and running. I think I also have one global upgrade for requisition, not sure though. Really low economy, but I'm working on it. Okay. But I have some resources already. You can say float, but I have them ready. So once I hit tier 3, you will know what I get. Right? What would the salamander get in tier 3? Look at the timing. Furnace in tier 3, almost at the same time, and getting the orbital relay and Primaris Aggressor Squad. Nice. Don't have all the upgrades here. I think I don't have any infantry upgrades, which is a little sad, but it's okay. I just need to hold a second. I see that my first aggressor squad is almost done, so I start moving, trying to get into position to make use of my soon to be tech advantage. Having the Death Squad Retron here taking so much damage isn't really. Does he have a melter on his side hand, or was it just looking like it? Now getting the relic, and it's almost time to spring the trap. Getting the second aggressive squad. We'll get Terminators as well. I see it here. Chaplain, move back. No, okay, I called it here. Attack! Jump the Deathrun Veteran in. And here they come. There you go. We have infiltrated transport though, but that's okay. Look at those guys. Now I have attached the Chaplain here. Taking a lot of damage. Need some detection. I will move the Sister Squad in a moment. Get the second aggressor squad here. I don't move them, I just get him into position. I think I get, yeah, I get some skull probes over here. And now they just mince everything. Yeah, even some barracudas here now cannot withstand. Sound is so nice. Now I have one squad with a skull probe for detection, one squad with the chaplain, getting all the upgrades here. Pop full, so I need to get a squad cap increase so I can get my Terminator squad out, which is now out here. And I think I just drop it here. I think I drop it here, right? Getting scouts to get some points back while I'm busy fighting, while the enemy is busy defending. Terminators have arrived. Getting assault cannons. Well, even though we are salamanders, just look at them. They look so nice. They are big salamander pauldrons. These look like little big babies though, but I think that's how they look. They are really strong, so I'm fine with it. Doing Terminators now, getting also the personal teleporters, which is really needed. Note that you can get Terminators from your orbital bombard, from the orbital relay and your ferries. Getting this relic down and now moving to the enemy base basically. I should and will at some point get the upgrades here as well. Even kill the scouts here. What a sad day. And now I notice that I need to take down the relic, but personal teleporters are up, so I can get one Terminator squad here. Decapping it and then teleporting them back to the front. Important is that you have your aggressors always being able to fight, because these are the ones that deal the most damage. Chaplain's still around buffing the regeneration of them. Now would be also a good time to get the Chaplain or the Force Commander here. I don't have the resources, or most of the time don't have the resources to get the infantry cap upgrade, but yeah, this is basically it. It's a full on tier 3.5 push here. We'll have the squad cap increase in a moment. I think at some point I'm starting to get the HP upgrades and damage upgrades, but yeah, that's pretty much it. Here you see it. Tier 3.5 is pretty strong for salamanders. The way to it is really hard. You have a strong tier 1 if you want to use thunderfire cannons. But other than that, you have tools for all tiers, you could say. But tier 3.5 particularly are strong with the aggressors and the terminators and whatnot. Here come the assault terminators, and that's pretty much GG's here. Really nice game. Normally I would have casted it for a Sunday for a max cast, but this game also really showcased different capabilities of salamanders, not including their vehicles. No vehicles built here, it's all infantry. But yeah, it shows the Primaris aggressors, the sisters, and whatnot. So guys, as always at the end of these guides, I say, if I have forgot something, write it in the comments. If I told bullshit about something, write it in the comments. If you have to add something, write it in the comments. If you like this video, write it in the comments. If you didn't like the videos, don't write it in the comments. No, you can also write some criticism, of course. But other than that, I always say here, thanks for watching, guys, and see you in the next video. Bye-bye.